Link TV, connecting you to the world. Link TV is viewer supported. Watch more at linktv.org.
Link TV presents Mosaic World News from the Middle East. Here are today's top stories.
Turkey close to severing ties with Israel over flotilla deaths. Al-Qaeda threatens to kidnap Saudi royals. And Iranian hardliners are threatened by reformers. Mosaic World News from the Middle East begins now.
Turkish Deputy Prime Minister Bülent Arinç said that Turkey may plan to reduce its relations with Israel to a minimum and that Turkey is serious about the matter.
But he indicated that it is not in his country's nature to completely sever its relations with or revoke its recognition of any country. Arinç also said that Israel carried out a crazy act and that the Turks never expected it to do such a thing and antagonize Turkey.
Turkey is still witnessing demonstrations and protests over what Israel did on the aid flotilla. A number of Turks gathered in front of the Israeli ambassador's home in Ankara to denounce Israel's behavior.
In the same context, the head of the Turkish Humanitarian Relief Foundation, Bülent Yildirim, told journalists in Istanbul that those who attacked us with weapons yesterday are attacking us today with lies, by directing allegations at us under the pretext of terrorism.
Yildirim added that if we were terrorists, then we would have supported Israel, because today it is the biggest terrorist in the world.
Those who attacked us with weapons yesterday are attacking us now in a different way. The Israeli government, which is dishonest, is lying about our organization. The art it knows best is the art of lying. Yes, it holds the emperorship of lying. No one will believe the lies orchestrated by Israel. The Israeli government accuses us of being affiliated with terrorists. This is a big lie. The Israelis killed 9 civilians while we were trying to provide first aid to their soldiers. They lie about us. This is a big lie. We were trying to send help to people and human beings. We tried to send aid. We were not trying to kill anyone, whereas they are killing people. We say this to the entire world. We are not terrorists. We have never supported any terrorists. If we were to support terrorists, we would have supported Israel, because there is no bigger terrorist than Israel in the entire world.
عمر ونتحول إلى مازن إبراهيم من إسطنبول. مازن.
Joining us from Istanbul is Al Jazeera correspondent Mazen Ibrahim. Mazen, are there any developments on the Turkish street that may push Turkey towards taking concrete measures against Israel?
In fact, the whole movement that is taking place now in Turkey, or more specifically in Istanbul, is led by local associations, social and civil organizations that are pressuring for the prosecution of Israel for the crimes that its soldiers committed during their raid on the Freedom Flotilla in international waters. In addition to the Turkish Humanitarian Relief Foundation and the association Mazlum Dar, or House for the Oppressed, there is support among the public to have an international prosecution of the Israeli leadership for what their soldiers did. The association Mazlum Dar presented a case to the Turkish Judicial Court based on a collection of human rights violations committed by the Israelis. There is support and a discussion is being held in relation to taking the matter to international courts. When Mazlum Dar submitted this case to the Judicial Court, it aimed to prevent Israeli officials from acting with impunity in case they decided to visit Turkey. This is in line with the call that was made today by the Turkish Humanitarian Relief Foundation during a press conference that was attended by activists who were aboard the Freedom Flotilla. Bülent Yildirim, the head of the foundation and one of the most prominent coordinators in this movement, the movement to break the siege on Gaza, said that the Israeli forces attacked the ships in international waters and used weapons on civilians, while disregarding that the elderly, children, and women were on board these ships. He indicated that what happened is documented with images, and that activists had obtained medical and forensic reports related to the 9 martyrs. All this material will be presented in the case.
Tears and angry statements resounded across the world as demonstrations continue to take place, demanding an end to the siege on Gaza. We leave you with Sukher Salam.
في باحة مسجد الفاتح بإسطنبول اختلطت مشاعر أهالي ضحايا الهجوم الإسرائيلي على
In Al-Fatah Mosque in Istanbul, the families of the victims who were killed in the Freedom Flotilla had mixed feelings. They were sad because they lost their sons and daughters, but they were also proud that the humanitarian mission had succeeded. A huge funeral procession was held for the victims, whose bodies were wrapped in both the Palestinian and the Turkish flags. Thousands of Turks participated in the funeral, as well as dozens of peace activists who came from all over the world to bid their farewell. Tens of thousands of people gathered in Istanbul to pray for the 8 Turkish victims who were killed in the Israeli attack on the Freedom Flotilla as they were trying to transport humanitarian aid to Gaza. They were yelling statements in solidarity with the Palestinians and in condemnation of Israel. In the aftermath of the attack on the Freedom Flotilla, the Turkish regional role was strengthened as it seemed that Prime Minister Recep Tayyip Erdogan has become a national hero.
If Israel continues to behave this way, it will lose its most important ally in the region. The Israeli government must reconsider its actions. They must ask themselves, what have they done? Israel has committed a historic mistake, not only on behalf of Turkey, but also on behalf of 32 other countries.
The crime that was committed against the Freedom Flotilla is no longer an Israeli-Turkish affair. World opinion is still shaken up by the ugliness of the Israeli crime. For example, in Indonesia, thousands of protesters took to the streets to condemn the Israeli crime, which was committed in international waters. This crime has highlighted the siege on Gaza and further deteriorated Israel's image in the world.
كشف جديد لما تعرضت له سفن قافلة الحرية خلال الهجوم الإسرائيلي جاء على لسان رئيس حزب المبادرة الوطنية.
The Secretary of the Palestinian Initiative, Dr. Mustafa al-Barghouti, revealed that the bottoms of the 3 ships were sabotaged underwater by Israeli commandos before they embarked and occupied them.
عملية احتلال الأسطول بالكامل من قبل الجيش الإسرائيلي.
بالمناسبه في نقطه غائبه عن الاعلام ان سفينتين او ثلاثه
By the way, one point that has not been reported in the media is the fact that the engines of 2 or 3 ships were sabotaged. Israeli commandos dived under the ships and sabotaged the engines. However, Israeli commandos could not sabotage the engines of the 5 other ships because we were moving quickly.
ولم تستطع قوات الكوماندوز الاسرائيليه ان تقوم بتخريبها. اذا هناك شيء اخر اسمه
Israel is also accused of sabotaging ships in international waters and subjecting the lives of the passengers on board to danger. These ships could sunk. It seems that the Israeli attack was planned. However, Israel is mainly concerned because its attack will not stop the ships aiming to break the siege in Gaza. Yesterday and today, I talked to people aboard a ship that sailed from Ireland heading to Gaza. The ship is called Rachel Corrie, in solidarity with a young American activist who was killed by the Israeli army in Gaza. On board the ship, we have Nobel Peace Prize laureate, Marit McGuire, who is a friend to the Palestinian people. She won the Nobel Peace Prize in Ireland. The ship also has a number of activists who are sailing toward Gaza. So the crime that was committed by Israel will not stop the ships from sailing to Gaza, rather it will increase them.
أيضا دكتور أياس سراج حضرتك موجود في غزة لا أعرف كيفية التواصل بين الفلسطينيين حاليا
Dr. Ayad Siraj, you live in Gaza. How do the Palestinians there communicate with the West Bank? From the outside, we have the feeling that the siege on Gaza has caused the Palestinians there to develop a different national identity than those in the West Bank. Do you or other independent figures try to bridge the gap between Gaza and the West Bank?
We are trying to build bridges of communication, both at the individual and organizational levels. Today, we mostly communicate with our Palestinian brothers in the West Bank through video conferences. We communicate with the rest of the world the same way. Most of the time, we also use the phone, email, and fax.
أن يستطيع واحد فينا أن يخرج من غزة.
I'm one of the lucky ones who managed to get out of Gaza after 4 years of trying to leave. Others have not been able to leave Gaza at all. There's a serious communication problem between the Palestinians. Former American President Jimmy Carter also talked about the effects of this siege. First, the siege is killing the civilization. In effect, it's an Israeli war on the Palestinian civilization. The siege in Gaza does not weaken Hamas. Rather, it strengthens extremists in Hamas. For example, the problems caused by the tunnels were due to the lack of a normal system to transport goods. The tunnels are used to smuggle weapons as well as other things. But if there were normal mechanisms to transport goods, then weapons couldn't be transported through the tunnels. The question is, where do the weapons go? They go to the extremists. Hamas now has plans, so the siege has empowered the extremist elements in Hamas.
I have read some of your ideas about Palestine. You say that the Arab-Israeli conflict is a clash of civilizations and that it is not a Palestinian-Israeli conflict, but an Arab-Israeli conflict. However, some Palestinians say that the establishment of Fatah marked the day in which the Palestinians started being in charge of their own affairs. In addition, the Oslo Peace Accords showed that Fatah was acting independently from the other Arab states. Others say that the Camp David Peace Accords showed that Egypt wanted to act independently, and that the Jordanian peace treaty with Israel showed that Jordan wanted to act in the same way. Why do you want the Palestinian-Israeli conflict to be an Arab-Israeli conflict, while Arab states are no longer involved in the Palestinian-Israeli conflict?
It is true that our problem is the big gap between our Arab dream and Arab policies. The Arab dream and the idea of pan-Arabism is still in our hearts and minds. We hope that one day the Arabs will have a common project, but regrettably the situation of Arab states has greatly deteriorated. Today, not only do we have problems between the Arab states and Israel, we also have problems between the Arab states, as well as between the Palestinians. I think that the Palestinian cause is an Arab cause. We are part of the Arab nation. Before Israel was established, Palestine was part of Greater Syria. The British and other Western powers divided the region with the Sykes-Picot Agreement. All Arab countries were one country, but the colonizers divided the region into states. We must reunite. This, however, does not mean that we should go back to the Ottoman Caliphate. Rather, all Arabs must unite. This is the demand of all Arabs, but the problem is the Arab regimes, which do not want to see the Arab masses united. Every Arab regime, regardless of whether it's ruled by a king, a party, or a tribe, is merely concerned about its personal interests and not the common good of the Arab masses. I think that the Arab governments that consider personal interests to be more important than the common good are wrong. As a result, all of us, part of the Arab nation, are facing a catastrophe. We do not have a united national program, and we are not united.
Al-Qaeda confirmed that Saudi authorities arrested the organization's most dangerous woman, Hila al-Qasair. Al-Qaeda released a video of its deputy leader in Yemen, Syed al-Shiri, calling on his supporters to kidnap senior Saudi officials and ministers in order to free Al-Qaeda's first lady. She was in charge of recruiting women and of collecting money. According to our Al Arabiya reporter, her last transfer to the organization reached $650,000.
Al-Qaeda's leadership in Yemen announced a state of alert after one of its female members was arrested. All of a sudden, the deputy leader of the organization, Saeed al-Shahiri, whose name is listed among the 85 wanted Saudis, revealed that the arrested woman was playing an important role in the organization. He discussed that Hila al-Qasair was arrested in the area of Burida, the capital of al-Qasim. Al-Qasair, who is 36 years old, has been on the run for the past year. Saudi security forces finally managed to arrest her in the home of a relative who is also wanted in al-Burida.
حتى حديث الشهير في التسجيل الصوتي الذي استمر.
الشهير's recorded message, which was 17 minutes long, revealed that Saudi Arabia still has Al-Qaeda sleeper cells. In the message, he clearly called on his supporters to carry out a large-scale operation in order to free Al-Qaeda's first lady, Hilla Al-Qusayr.
Just like it is our duty to free her, it is also your duty to do so, especially the residents of the Qasim and all Muslims in the Arabian Peninsula and elsewhere. We are not saying that you have to leave your country. Rather, you should stay in it and prepare everything you can, collect information, incite Muslims, and collect money to form active cells to kidnap Christians, Saudi princes, and senior officials, including ministers and military officers. We tell our soldiers you have to carry out some kidnapping operations to free the prisoners. Regarding this issue, you should become a model for your brothers.
Political observers believe that Al-Qaeda's new strategy of kidnapping Saudi princes and ministers shows that the arrested woman is important for the organization. Through her, Saudi security agencies managed to arrest 25 members of Al-Qaeda. Hilla Al-Qusayr was once married to a religious extremist, Sheikh Abdul Karim Al-Habid, who has been in prison for years. After their divorce, she married an Al-Qaeda member, Muhammad Al-Wukayl, who was killed in Riyadh during a clash with Saudi security forces on the 29th of December 2004. She gave birth to a girl and continued to receive a monthly check from the Saudi authorities to help her raise her child. Political observers believe that the latest recorded message of the deputy leader of the organization, Saeed Al-Shahiri, shows that the organization has changed its strategy. This means that this summer will be a hot one, as the Saudi security forces will continue to search for sleeper cells. Ahmed Tayan, Al Arabiya.
There have been many reactions to the new threat that was made by Al-Qaeda's deputy leader in Yemen, Saeed Al-Shahiri.
He's calling on his supporters to kidnap princes, ministers, and Saudi security forces in order to free Al-Qaeda member Hilla Al-Qusayr, was resented by the Saudi public.
This is wishful thinking. Neither him or anyone else will manage to do what he's calling for. Regardless of the cost, he will be stopped. Saudi Arabia is awake. Saudi citizens are awake. The security forces are watching everything day and night. All the people are in charge of protecting their country. We totally reject this way of thinking.
I heard the message of the miserable Al-Shahiri, in which he called on his supporters to kidnap citizens, security forces, and leaders. This comes as Israel attacked Islam and Muslims, which shows that Al-Qaeda does not have clear objectives or any vision.
The Saudi media extensively covered the message of Al-Shahiri. After the message was published, the people's reactions and views were also published. Religious leaders said that Al-Qaeda is trying to use a woman as a way to gain the sympathy of the Saudi public, pointing out that the organization has constantly been attacking Muslims.
They do not want Saudi Arabia to succeed. They are the enemies of God. They are apostates who disobey rulers and religious leaders. I swear to God that our differences with them are not over religious concepts. Rather, we do not agree with them because of their hate for this country.
Political observers say that every year Al-Qaeda comes up with new reasons to continue its activities, which shows that the number of its sympathizers is decreasing. Al-Qaeda's call on its supporters to attack Saudi citizens, princes, security forces, and ministers shows that the organization is in a state of panic. In the beginning, it was targeting Westerners in Saudi Arabia and justifying it with religion. Now they are giving up the religious justification, thus exposing themselves to what they are really about. From Riyadh, Mohammed Al-Yosei, Al Arabiya.
Al Arabiya.
قال الرئيس الإيراني أحمد نجاد لحشد كبير من مؤيديه في طهران.
Iranian President Mahmoud Ahmadinejad told a large crowd of his supporters in Tehran that his government will not tolerate any collaboration with anyone who antagonizes the Islamic Revolution. In another development, Russia and China posed new attempts by the UN Security Council to rush the sanctions on Iran over its nuclear program. This comes as the United States said that the Security Council intends to impose new sanctions on Tehran soon. Joining us over the phone from Tehran is Dr. Mohammad Saleh Siddiqian, director of the Iranian Center for Arab Studies. Mr. Siddiqian, first of all, why did the president use a sharp warning with his supporters, and why shouldn't he have done so?
بالتأكيد هذه التحذيرات التي أطلقها مرشد الجمهورية الإسلامية آيت الله علي خامنئي والرئيس الإيراني أحمد.
Of course, the warnings made by the Supreme Leader of the Islamic Republic, Ayatollah Ali Khamenei, and the Iranian President Ahmadinejad came within the context of the incidents that took place in Iran last year after the results of the presidential elections were announced. The implications of these incidents still affect Iran. The messages sent by the highest-ranking Iranian leadership to those who Ahmadinejad believes are trying to jeopardize the Iranian people's interests and manipulate the principles of the revolution that were brought about by the late president Imam Khomeini.
وبالتالي أنا أعتقد بأن الأمور لن تتجه باتجاه التسوية وإنما باتجاه.
Second, I think that the matter is not moving towards a resolution. Rather, it is escalating.
But those who protested the announcement of the presidential election results say that their action was a revolution within the revolution, and that it did not deviate from the path of Wilayat Faqih or the guardianship of the jurists. The Faqih system, as a whole, is the government's regime that was brought upon by the Islamic revolution.
That is very true. The Iranian opposition, including the two candidates who lost in the elections, Mir Hussein Mousavi and Mehdi Karoubi, still believe in Iran's political system and even the Faqih system. They acknowledge the Faqih system and do not oppose the Iranian constitution. But it seems that the hardliners in Iran believe that the Iranian government should strike down the reformist movement, because they believe that this movement may work with foreign powers against the regime's interests and in opposition to the direction set for the country by the late Imam Khomeini.
From Tehran, Dr. Mohammad Saleh Siddiqian, director of the Iranian Center for Arab Studies, thank you.
9 activists are killed as a result of the Israeli attack on an aid flotilla heading to Gaza. Israel claims that the activists were armed. But thousands of outraged demonstrators pour into the streets of major cities across the globe to condemn Israel. Was the attack justified, or was there a cover-up?
Answers to these questions and more on Link TV's Mosaic Intelligence Report.
As thousands of outraged demonstrators poured into the streets of Ankara and several capitals across the globe in the aftermath of Israel's bloody attack on an aid flotilla bound for the Gaza Strip early Monday. An Israeli sergeant stood in front of reporters claiming that the activists on board were armed with knives, scissors, pepper spray, and guns. He said he was armed only with a paintball rifle. It was a civilian paintball gun that any 12-year-old can play with, he said. Yet, at least 9 activists were killed, including a 19-year-old American who was shot in the head 4 times, and scores were injured. Soon after, a video was released on the official website of the Israel Defense Forces and was made available to the media. It showed Israeli paratroopers jumping onto the International Gaza Aid Flotilla, a clip showing IDF commandos being beaten as they boarded the ship, and one thrown overboard was looped endlessly. The military video did not show how and when the activists were shot, although the Israeli helicopter's infrared cameras would have easily recorded the flashes caused by gun discharge. Instead, the IDF has selectively released only a portion of the tape that showed its commandos under attack but has omitted the killings.
The organizers on board the Mavi Marmara, after 2 people have been confirmed killed by the Israeli army, have now asked all the passengers to go inside.
Both Al Jazeera and reporters from Turkish TV news channels were reporting that the Marmara was under gunfire.
They were clubbed, they were beaten, stabbed. There was even a report of gunfire.
The lynch scenario came next. The victims were not the 9 dead activists, nor the dozens of internationals who were beaten, humiliated, and dragged against their will to the Israeli port of Ashdod. Instead, they were the IDF's finest. What a departure from the days of Entebbe, when Hollywood made legends out of Israeli commandos. Israel's foreign ministry then started showing pictures of sticks, knives, slingshots, and bottles, which they said were the activists' weapons. The message is that several hundred activists gathered from all over the world to confront one of the best equipped and trained militaries in the world with these. But we are then told that the activists weren't really activists at all, but rather terrorists with ties to Hamas and Al-Qaeda. Yedioth Ahronot, one of Israel's most widely circulated papers, broke with the headlines: a brutal ambush at sea. Arutz Sheva, the official news site of the settler movement, attacked Associated Press for its biased reporting with an article entitled "Media War on the Flotilla Clash, AP Anti-Israel Bias Exposed." And the IDF website had this blaring story: attackers of the IDF soldiers are found to be Al-Qaeda mercenaries, later to be reported in the Jerusalem Post as IDF mercenaries to blame for violence. Israel's Hasbara at its best. But is it working? Hasbara is only succeeding in Israel, says veteran journalist David Michaelis.
We Israelis are living in a parallel universe. We're trying to explain to ourselves in Hebrew through our Hasbara that we are so justified in everything we are doing. But we also think that we are convincing the world, while the world doesn't really listen to our arguments, and it's a self-defeating kind of strategy.
Michaelis believes that there is a disconnect between the way Israel sees itself and its actions and the way they are viewed by the rest of the world.
This wasn't a love boat. This was a hate boat. These weren't pacifists, they weren't peace activists. These were violent supporters of terrorism,
said Israel's Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu. A nice soundbite for Fox News and the headlines for the New York Post. But this time, Hasbara is not working. Not after the war on Lebanon, Operation Cast Lead in Gaza, and a Mossad assassination caught on tape in Dubai. I'm Jamal Dajani for the Mosaic Intelligence Report.
To learn more about this program or to share your thoughts, visit us at linktv.org/me. Stay up to date on the Middle East. Follow Jamal at twitter.com/JamalDajani. The views expressed on Mosaic are from contributing broadcasters, not Link TV or its sponsors. The production of Mosaic is made possible from support of viewers like you. Thank you. Watch Mosaic World News online, stay up to date with breaking news, read our blog, get transcripts of past shows and more at linktv.org/mosaic.
This program is brought to you by Link TV for educational and non-commercial use only. Link TV is the only U.S. network dedicated to global and national news, uncompromising documentaries, and diverse cultural programs, programs which connect you to the world.